Hello, and welcome back to another episode with It's Dr. Dan, and today we're going to be learning about the basics of nuclear chemistry. So with nuclear chemistry, what this is all about is an unstable nucleus that is decaying, it's falling apart, maybe it's going through all kinds of different reactions. So today we're going to be mainly focusing on how this is breaking apart and some of the different types of nuclear equations that you could possibly see and how to balance them. So when we go through this, we're going to go through the definitions, the four different types of particles that you're going to see, and we'll go through the tips and tricks on how to balance these. Let's go take a look at how these types of little unstable nuclei, like the one we see here, how it's going to break apart. Right, so the basic idea of radioactivity, it comes from an unstable nuclei when they're ready to break apart. It's like taking a Lego sculpture and smashing it against the wall. It could break apart in all kinds of different ways. Now, these are mainly found in atomic nuclei that are generally higher than 20, and that's because the more protons that we have in the nucleus, like the one that is drawn all the way up top here, right, like the one here, it has a lot of protons, a lot of neutrons. So I have protons in red, neutrons in blue. Now, the more of these that you add, their protons are going to start repelling each other, right? Like charges, they don't like being near each other. So they get a little bit unstable. So when that happens, they can break apart. And as a result, when they do break apart, they can emit all kinds of different radiation. So they could be in the form of what we call alpha particles, beta particles, positrons, or gamma ray emissions. Now, when this is released, this could have a huge effect, something that could be used in the medical industry. It could be something that's found in the world around us. It could be used in all kinds of different applications or for energy, you name it. Now, when these happen, this is a way for these atoms, for them, or isotopes to relax back down. So ultimately, it's going to help it become more stable when it does that. So let's take a look at the four different types more in depth. So what this is all going to start with is starting with the radioisotope, which is just a normal isotope that we've seen since general chemistry. And if you need some help with that, refer back to my videos on how we can look at atomic masses, counting protons and neutrons, and looking at our atomic numbers. So with here, right, all these different isotopes that exist for an element, we're going to be showing that with a whole atomic mass number. So this is going to be one that's going to be emitting radiation. Now, there could be more than one isotope for every single one of these elements, right? If you look at your periodic table, this is an average. So I would recommend having your periodic table handy, either on as a side window or in front of you, so that way when we're doing the examples together, you can follow along. So the different types, like I mentioned before, there are four major types that we're going to be seeing. Each one of them has a different representation, so I would recommend writing each one of these down because you need to know them in order to balance the different equations. So the very first one is an alpha particle. This is the heaviest out of all of them because this is represented with a helium atom. It's equivalent of two protons and two neutrons breaking off of a nucleus. Now, with this thing, as you can kind of imagine, is a very slower moving particle because it's bigger. But even though it's slower, it can do a lot of damage if it's on the inside of you. Let's say if you ingest it, it's not going to be able to get out. It's something that is very, very dangerous. So we write that as a helium atom. The next one is a beta particle. This is a high energy electron. So typically we write this as a -1 in the atomic number spot. And electrons, if you remember, have an atomic mass of about 0. So we put 0 here and we just use the E to represent electron. Now, don't get this confused with the third one, which is a positron. Positrons and beta particles are written very similarly to one another. Beta particles, what we just talked about, is a negative particle. Positrons, think of the name positive, is a positive molecule, or not molecule, electron in this case. So when we talk about the positron, this is referred to as antimatter, meaning the way that we show this is a +1 next to the E. So we write a beta plus for this electron versus the other one, we would show the electron with a -1 on the other side. Now, the last thing that we're going to have for our last one is the gamma ray, which is on the very bottom here. The gamma ray is a pure form of energy. That all it is just a release. So when this happens, this could be something used for chemotherapy. It could be used to try to destroy certain things maybe found in the body. It is just pure energy. So how do we use these? We're going to learn how to balance chemical reactions. We're going to go through the steps, and I'm going to go and review some different tips as we go through balancing an example for each one of these. Now, these are really important reactions to understand the basics for people in radiation technology or anyone interested maybe in the medical field, or if you're just interested in basic chemistry. So I'd really pay attention and take some really good notes as we move forward. Okay, with balancing nuclear equations, the big thing with these is when we're balancing them, it's way easier than balancing a chemical reaction. The idea is what goes in must come out. If you remember the law of mass composition, so what you have on the left side, let's say in the reactants, must be the same side on the right side of the products, it's going to be the same thing here. But instead, all we're going to be doing is adding up the sum of the atomic masses and the sum of the atomic numbers. They got to be equal on the left and right. So let's go through some examples and show what this is all about when I say it has to be equal on the left and the right. So make sure you have your periodic tables because that's what's going to help. So with the first one, we're going to be doing uranium. So it says uranium-238. So when we write this down, what we need to do is fill in all the little blanks, and it's going to be an alpha particle. So the way I like to show these is if you remember, every one of them has an atomic number. They also have a mass number. So we have a spot for both of those. Now, the next thing we need to do is identify what type of emission process is it. This one is alpha. So if you can kind of remember, all right, we had the four particles earlier. Alpha was represented by a helium atom. So we'd put that four, the two, and we'd show that. Now, when something's going into a decay, it's going to be breaking apart this nucleus, and it's going to be turning from a parent nuclei into a daughter nuclei, meaning we're going to break apart even further and make a new nucleus when this happens. So when we have this, we are going to have something that's brand new being created on the right side as a product. So now before we can do this, we need to know what uranium's atomic number is, and if you look it up on the periodic table, you'll see it has a mass of 92. So we'll fill that in our first box. Now, before I mention what is on the left side must equal what is on the right. So we have our left, and then we have our right. So reactants must equal products. So on the bottom here, this has to have a total of 92 because we have 92 on the left-hand side. So what is 2 plus X? How do you get 92? Well, 2 plus 90 is going to be 92. So we'll fill that in, right? We'll put the 90. Now, the same idea for what's on top over here. This has to equal to 238. The sums have to be equal. So what's 4 plus X to get to 238? That's 234. So we'll take 234 plus 4. That equals 238. So what element is number 90, right? If you remember, this number is like a fingerprint for how to determine all the different unknown elements that are out there. So when we take our periodic table, we'll look up what the atomic number is for number 90. And what you're going to see is that this one is thorium. So this is how you balance it, right? We have the same amount of mass on the right-hand side as we do on the left. And we're going to do this for each individual one. The hardest part is remembering the four particles. Can you add? We can all add, right? We can go through those basic steps. So let's take a look at the next one. Let's do another one together. This question is, what is the alpha decay of americium-241? So generally, a lot of these problems, you're just given just a name. So what do we have to do is we got to set up the problem, right? We have americium-241. We need to know what the number is. So when we look it up in the periodic table, you'll quickly see that the number is 95. So remember, that atomic number is the same no matter what isotope it is. They all have that atomic number of 95. Mass might be different from your periodic table. That doesn't matter because we're referring to this specific isotope. So the first thing is, it's an alpha decay, so we're going to write a helium. Now the next thing what we're going to do is we got to fill in the little boxes. So what is going to be created? Well, the mass has to be a total of 241, and then the atomic number has to be a total of 95. So let's start with the atomic mass. So if we have our atomic mass, how do we get to 241? Well, we need 4 plus 237 on top. That's how you equal 241. Now, how do you get to 95 on the bottom? Well, we're going to add that to 93. All right, so now what do we do is we got to look up what is number 93 on our periodic table. And what you are going to quickly find is that this is neptunium. So when this radioactive decay happens, or this alpha decay, when this nuclei breaks apart, it's going to make a new element of neptunium, which will be a slightly more stable nucleus. And this reaction could keep going for until it eventually becomes stable. But that's the ultimate goal. Let's go on to the next one. Okay, let's write an equation for the beta decay of potassium 42. So with K42, how would we show this? Well, being that we have our following element, we would write down our elemental, our atomic number, our atomic mass, and we're going to show how this is going to break down. Now with beta decay, how is that one different than alpha decay? Well, it was 0, negative 1 is equivalent to an electron breaking off. So a high energy electron. Now the math for this is going to be a little bit different. So what's on top has to equal to 42, and what's on the bottom has to equal to 19. Now the thing is, we're adding a negative number in here. So how do we get to 19 with a negative? Well, if we do 20 plus negative 1, that's going to equal 19. And then on top, we'll have 42. So 0 plus 42 is still 42. So what element would we have that is not as 20? So we'd go through our periodic table. You'd see quickly that calcium is your 42. Now, can beta decay only happen this way? Well, with any of these different processes, they can either be fission, which is breaking apart, or fusion, which is coming together. So we've been showing decay, which is all about how things are going or breaking and going through fission. Fusion is when we want to bring them together. So you could show the opposite, which is, let's say if I want to capture an electron. So being that if you think of K42-19, and I want to capture an electron, or in this case, a beta particle, how would this change? Well, it's going to be the same general idea, right? We want to write our little boxes, and how much, whatever the total is on the left, has to equal what the total is on the right. So we can see we have 42 and 18. These are going to be the numbers that we're going to be filling in. So then what are we going to do here is we're going to look up atomic number 18 on your periodic table, and you're going to quickly see that this is going to be argon, which is the answer for this one. So then that's beta decay. Let's take a look at the last two different reactions. Now, the easiest one that we can really see is gamma radiation, which, why is that one easier, right? We're just adding up the sums. Well, what this one is energy that's emitted from an unstable nucleus. So it's just pure energy. The way that we show this is whenever it's referring to a gamma radiation problem, you can see that there is a little M written next to the 99 or the mass. This is telling you it's metastable and something that's going to break apart. Well, gamma radiation is shown as 00 gamma. So we need to make sure the same thing on the left is what's equal to the right, meaning that it's still going to be 9943 technetium, but we get rid of the M. So, and that's an example of gamma. Gamma, it's the same element in the end, it's the same radioisotope, but it loses its energy in the form of, you know, electromagnetic radiation. This could be used maybe in the form of chemotherapy or generally something to really destroy something very harmful. So let's go on to our last examples. All right, let's write the nuclear equation for the positron emission of manganese 49. So with this one, right, when we want to show manganese, we would still go through the exact same process that we've been going through, but it's talking about a positron. So emission is all about breaking apart. So when we show that positron coming off, right, we show a 0 plus 1. It's also very common to show it as a 0 with a beta with a positive next to it and put plus 1. So either or can be used in these problems. It all depends on kind of where you're learning it and really what your field of study is, but they both are applicable here. I like using both. So same premise as before, right? What's on top or what's on the left must equal the right. So being that we have a mass total of 49 on the left-hand side, we have to have a total of 25 for our atomic number. So what we can see quickly, right, if I do 24 plus 1, that will equal 25. And on top, when I do 49 plus 0, that will equal 49. So which element would be number 24? This would be chromium, and that would be the answer for that. Now, the last part that I'll talk about positrons is, what about protons? How could they decay? Let's look at a more theoretical one. So protons can be shown two ways. They can either be represented as the letter P, where we show one as the atomic number atomic mass, and one for the atomic number, being that there's only a proton, right? There's no nucleus. This is the same thing as representing a hydrogen, which if you think on your periodic table, has the number one as the atomic mass and the atomic number. So you can use either. Now, if I wanted to say, hey, how is this going to break apart as a positron decay? Well, how do we show it? Well, it's 0 plus 1, and let's do the beta symbol. How would we balance the top and the bottom? Well, remember, what's on the left must equal what's on the right. And you can already see, well, the bottom is equal, so this has to be a 0, and what's on top has to be a 1. What particle has an atomic mass of 1 and no atomic number? What could that possibly be? That's none of the particles we went through, none of the four. But it is a subatomic particle, right? Protons have a mass of 1. So do neutrons. So this is a neutron. So when a proton goes through positron decay, this makes a neutron, right? So you can have either protons, or you can have neutrons, which can both be shown. So I would write that down, showing how neutrons are a particle, because a lot of nuclear reactions can break apart a neutron or be bombarded or collided with a neutron to combine with them. So there's all kinds of different reactions. I hope that this video helped you. This is the basics in nuclear chemistry. This will help you kind of understand some of the things that go on in radiation technology and some future reactions and future videos to come. Thank you so much for watching, and I hope to see you all in the future. Bye now.